I'm not going to do any long introductions. The panel title is Truth, Healing and Change, a Cross-Cultural Collaboration, and I'm pleased to welcome Denise Altvater, Esther Attean and Penthea Burns.
Good morning. We're happy to be here this morning. We spent a lot of time last night changing our presentation because we had originally, we're going to share some history, but we got all of that yesterday. So we thought we would just start by telling the story of how we got to where we are today from where we started. So this slide, it's a picture of what is now known as the state of Maine. It's a part of Wabanaki territory. As Rebecca had mentioned yesterday, Wabanaki people have suffered from colonization longer than a lot of other nations. Chkwabin means the dawn. Chkwabinikuk Wabanaki are the people of the dawn, where the sun first hits Turtle Island. And as we already mentioned, there were once about 30 tribes in our confederacy, and five of them remain today. This slide shows in red. Oops, see, I've got two laptops going, sorry. This slide, what you see in red represents all of the fee lands, trust lands, and reservation lands that Wabanaki people hold title to today. You can see Zibayig, or Pleasant Point, is Zibayig, where Denise and I are from, and Indian Township is the other Passamaquoddy or Beskumukuddy reservation. It's Madokmiguk, the upriver Passamaquoddy, as they call them. And you can see where Indian Island is. That's Bunawabskewi, the place of the White Rocks, where Penobscot people live. And up north in Holton is Wollastoguk, the Maliseet, and near Presque Isle is the Mi'kmaq people. So it's a pretty big state. When Charlotte talked about Rachel George, the research coordinator, traveling thousands of miles, she certainly did. I just found this picture. It's been a long, this is an old picture. This is a picture of the ICWA work group we formed in 1999 in Maine. And I just want to mention the lady in the front, on the second one on the left, Betsy Tanyan. She's a Penobscot woman that was part of our group early on. And yesterday when folks were talking about the Carlisle Indian Industrial School and that marker that's there to recognize those graves, Betsy had quite a lot to do with that. She was a UDAL fellow, and her cohort visited Carlisle, and she was so overcome with emotion and wanted to make sure that there was a way that people knew that those children were buried there. So her and her UDAL fellows lobbied the Carlisle, whomever, I can't remember that, Barbara Landis, I think, is the curator there, talked with her, and they got a marker. So I just wanted to give a shout out to Betsy's efforts. So in 1999 in Maine, it was kind of like this perfect storm of events that was happening. We know that the Child and Family Services, the state of Maine Office of Child and Family Services, participated in a pilot review from the federal government because they knew if they participated in the pilot review, they wouldn't have to do the full review after. And that review found that they were out of compliance with the Indian Child Welfare Act. And to their credit, they reached out to the tribes for help in developing a training for their caseworkers. Also in 1999, the state of Maine Office of Child and Family Services had quite a tragedy. There was a death of a young girl named Logan Marr, who was a foster child. She was killed by her foster mother, who was an ex-DHHS caseworker. So there was the department was under a lot of scrutiny. And at the same time in that year, the chief of the Maliseets in Wollastoguk, Brenda Commander, perfect name for a chief. She's the longest, I think she's in her 16th year, or maybe even longer than that. So one thing that's important to understand to get this story right is the Passamaquoddies and Penobscots have our own tribal court, as they mentioned, so we can claim exclusive jurisdiction over our children in our territory. The Maliseets and the Mi'kmaqs don't have a tribal court, so the state of Maine has exclusive jurisdiction over all their child welfare cases. So in the fall of 99, Brenda got a call from one of her tribal members that the state was there to take her children. So Brenda went down to intervene to find out what was happening. There was a police officer, a caseworker, and a supervisor, and they handed Brenda this court order to take these children. Brenda read it. It wasn't signed by a judge, so it was not legal. And not they didn't actually hand it to her. They threw it at her. So she promptly told them to leave. And the stand that she took that day, and to their, you know, the Maliseet's credit and Brenda's credit, they the next day they sat down with the state, and they came up with a pretty powerful historic tribal state agreement that gave Maliseets and actually all the tribes maximum participation in their child welfare cases. So at the same time, in November, the state of Maine sends these letters to all the tribal child welfare departments, and I was working for Penobscot Nation at the time, and our reaction was, oh yeah, they need us now. Now they need our help, right, because they're in danger of losing funding. But we all showed up, and I'll let... Okay, I got a timeline here that will keep up there while we talk about this story. And Denise and Penthea are going to jump in as well. So when we got together in 1999, it gets a little more serendipitous because Penthea Burns had just started working for the Muskie School of Public Service, and under a state contract, the state said, we want somebody from the Muskie School to go coordinate this this work between the tribes and the state to develop ICWA compliance trainings. And Penthea was the person that got the, she calls it an honor, but at the time I don't think it was. It was a pretty brutal experience. And to make it even more serendipitous, it turns out that Denise was in foster care as a child in Hamden, and Penn was her neighbor friend. And they hadn't seen each other since, what, 40 years. So when you talk about everything aligning, so the first meeting, I remember it pretty well. As I said, I was working for Penobscot Nation. That's not my community. I was a guest in that community. And not only was it the first time that the tribes and the state got together to talk about child welfare, it was the first time the tribal child welfare people had been in the same room together. We didn't know what each other was doing. It was very tense. I don't know, you can talk about how tense it was from your point of view. But what we stayed at the table and we thought, okay, we have this project to do, we're gonna develop this training, we're gonna train all of the caseworkers in the state of Maine, which is about 500, and you know, and then we'll be done. And it'll just be this neat little project. But it's easy to see now looking back how life-changing it was. But at the time, we didn't know that. We were kind of wading through mud. Our thinking was, at the time, state caseworkers get about 6 weeks of training before they can start their job. And this is called pre-service training. And that pre-service training at the time included maybe a half hour on the Indian Child Welfare Act. They would be given the law, and then, you know, this is what you have to follow. And many of these caseworkers would never see an ICWA case, depending on what area of the state they were. So we thought, well, they're not following the law, and you know, they clearly have a copy of the law, they're not following it. Why? And Betsy had a lot to do with, because of her experience with that boarding school, visiting Carlisle, she had a lot to do with changing our thinking and really saying, you know, they need to know why the Indian Child Welfare Act was a necessary legislation. They need to know the history. Our hope was that if they understood it, they would be more apt to follow it if they could internalize that. So you see on here all of these little things we did, and we could talk about, you know, we could talk about the case review tool we did that was pretty historic. We could talk about the policy that we created and the ICWA summits we held. But as you see all those things we did, the other thing that was happening at the same time is we were starting to understand intergenerational trauma. We didn't call it that. We didn't know what it was. But with these trainings we did, the first 500 mandatory trainings for the 500 caseworkers, five trainings around the state, we wanted to share, we wanted the caseworkers to hear from Wabanaki people who had been in state child welfare custody prior to 1978. And it was not logistically possible to have a panel of these Native people go to all of these trainings. So we decided to make a video. We didn't know how to make a video, but we did. We identified folks in all of our communities. We had about 10 Wabanaki people that Penthea interviewed, and they shared their story. They told us what happened to them. They told us how what happened to them has impacted them personally and in their families and in their communities. And we asked them for their advice. What advice would you give a caseworker that's working with a Native person? And we learned a lot in making that film. We made a very grave mistake. And now it's a mistake that we would not make now, but it's just indicative of our lack of understanding and just going into this new territory. We asked all these folks to share their story. They did it very graciously and very willingly, and we didn't pay one bit of attention to what that did to them. And every time we tell this story, it doesn't get any easier to say what we did. Some of these people, you know, had been in recovery for a while, shared their story, started drinking. You know, one woman ended up in a lockdown psychiatric unit. So we didn't pay attention to that. Like I said, we didn't know what we didn't know. But the other lesson that we learned from that video is all of the people, we saw these themes that were developing when they were telling their story. And every one of them were parents themselves. And they talked about, when they talked about being taken and leaving the reservation, leaving the community, now, I don't want to say it didn't matter how they were taken. Some of them, they were taken in different ways. Some of them, you know, the classic textbook best practice, kneel down, explain to the child, be very compassionate. Or, you know, the other end of the continuum, show up, throw their stuff in a bag, put them in the car, take them, and don't even speak to them. And regardless of how they were taken, the impact and the trauma of being taken was the same. Regardless of how they were treated while they were in care, you know, and were different, varied experiences. Some of them were abused, tortured. Some of them were loved, cared for. Their adoptive or foster family worked hard to try to keep their connection to their community. And that didn't matter. I don't want to say it didn't matter, but regardless of their experiences in care, that they all had this thing, and it's really hard to articulate, but this one woman on the video, we called the video belonging, because that was a theme that came up, is that lack of belonging and that need to belong. And this woman on the video says, you know, I love my children, but I can do without them. And that was what we now know is intergenerational trauma. At the time, we didn't know that. So this video was very, very critical to our learning. So in all of these things that we did, some of these trainings we did, the pre-service training that we did and the in-service training, we do all of these activities with the caseworkers. And one of the things we did was have them go through this exercise where they would have to list what happens to a child when they come into foster care. And the list was big. And they would say, what happens to a Native child when they come into foster care? And it made them have to think, well, what's the difference, and why are, you know, we got all these questions like, why are Native people so special, and what makes you, that safety first, ICWA second kind of mentality. And what we didn't realize, that Penn and I were just talking about this last night, what we didn't realize is that we were just kind of teasing all of these issues around, like Charlotte talked about, pulling those threads and how they're all connected, and we didn't have the words and the ability to articulate, or even didn't even know it at the time, that we were talking about how history and what has happened to us and how oppression impacts us today and that intergenerational trauma. So We did these statewide trainings, and we stayed together because we thought that there were more work to do. We developed great relationships between the tribal child welfare staff and the OCFS casework staff. But it was all up here, right? It was all, we knew that what best practice was, we knew what we wanted to, what goal we had was best practice for Wabanaki children and families. And it wasn't until we were able to move it down to here that the work really took off. It's almost like we would join in arms and say, oh, we're gonna do this together. And having this good relationship that was kind of superficial. So this one very critical meeting we had, we did this activity with the folks in the group based on tenets of reevaluation counseling or co-counseling. And it's, you can look it up, it's not a professional association or it's just two people sharing time, equal time and equal attention. So we divided up into groups of three. We're gonna have you guys do this today, but we changed our mind. We got into groups of three, and the method is one person would talk for 2 minutes and the other two people just give them their complete attention and their complete positive regard. And after that meeting, everything changed. We got to sit with each other and hear. I think the question we had them ask, no.
5 minutes. We're just sharing the time.
Allie. I think the question was, share something about yourself that you would want somebody, want the others to know, that nobody knows about you. And that is when we were able to connect with each other right here. And I think I'm probably representing it okay, speaking for Dee Dee and Penn, that was a very life-changing experience for all of us. What it did was it enabled, because the Native people around the table, many of us are in these positions and doing this work because the survival of our people depends on it. The non-Native people around the table, it was a job, right? They had a hat to wear, and they had a job to do, and they had rules to follow. And until we did that, doing that helped them be able to bring their whole selves into this work, which is not something that they are able to do on a daily basis in their job. You know, they can't be who they are, because who they are sometimes conflicts with who they're supposed to be in these jobs. So it really pushed us forward. But in spite of all of this great work that was happening, things were still needed to change. The tribal caseworkers would, the only way that I can describe it is they say, we only get so far and we hit this invisible wall. And what we realized is that we were going forward without really going back. And we weren't really processing and grieving about how history has impacted all of us. So in 2008, somebody had this idea, serendipitously, as everything else happens, for a Truth and Reconciliation Commission process. And we decided, I remember we had a meeting in May of 2008 with people from state government, all levels of state government, and our tribal child welfare people, and we said, do you want to do this with us? And they said, yeah. When you are all ready for us, let us know when to come back to the table. And we really needed that space because we didn't know truth about what? Reconciliation about what? What is the it? That's what we used to call our meetings. What is the it? And we'd have to schedule, it was just the tribal folks, and we'd have to schedule our meetings at the end of the day because we couldn't function after them because there was so much grief and so much pain. I remember when one of the members right there in front of us at that table remembered that she was in foster care as a child. She had hit it. She didn't even know. I know when we interviewed folks for that video, like Denise, she didn't even know she had a story to tell at the time. I'll just go through this real quick and let Penn and Dee Dee talk. In 2011, we worked from 2008 till 2011 to draft the a mandate, not a mandate, what's it called? The declaration of intent is the first thing you have to do when you do a Truth and Reconciliation Commission process. We learned a lot from the folks in Greensboro, North Carolina. That was the place of the first official Truth Commission in the United States, and it was dealing with the Klan murders of 5 Communist Labor Party workers in 1979. And they helped us a lot with the process. And I just want to tell one little story about writing this Declaration of Intent. It was a wonderful experience for the tribal people. I remember we put paper all over the wall, and we said, okay, this Declaration of Intent, it's going to say, whereas this and this and this and this, you know. So we were going to put all of our truths on this paper. It was 6 pages long. You know, they put up that on the wall, what they did to us. You know, when we had to block the road at Pleasant Point because the state stopped delivering milk to our community, you know, and we took over the highway and all of these things. So we were feeling pretty proud of ourselves. We invited the state back to the table in February of 2011, and we showed them our you know, draft Declaration of Intent. And that was a critical moment, because oftentimes in tribal state relations in Maine, we're placated. I don't know if it's fear, they don't want to piss off the Indians. I don't know if it's just disregard and disrespect, or they don't want to be politically incorrect, but we get away with a lot of stuff sometimes. And this wasn't the case with this group of people. They pushed back. They said, there's no way that we could sign this. You know, it already says, it always has this damning evidence here. We can't sign this. And 2 things happened. It was great because they respected us enough to give us that feedback and that pushback. And we knew that the process we went through for those couple years to develop this Declaration of Intent was far more valuable than that piece of paper, those 6 pieces of paper that we produced. And we knew that if we were going to do this in a truly collaborative way, then they needed to be part of that process of writing that Declaration of Intent with us. So we started over, and we came up with a 1-page document, page and a half after the attorneys put some disclaimers in there. The other thing that was very important about that is we decided, at that moment, we knew that we had to trust this process that we would develop and that we had to let go, and that this commission was going to do this investigation independent of us and as an autonomous body, and we just had to trust that they would come to the same truth that we already knew. A lot of letting go with this process. So this is a picture of us at the ceremony for the signing of the Declaration of Intent. Very historic day. First Truth and Reconciliation Commission process in the United States that addresses Native child welfare issues. And our friends at ICTJ in New York City, International Center for Transitional Justice, let us know that it's the first TRC process in the world that's been developed by people that represent both sides of the issues, and the first between tribal nations and a state government, and the first that has healing in it. We didn't really believe them at the time until we started getting calls from international media. This is just a picture of the signatories. Governor LePage, some of you might have heard about him in the news, maybe, on the comedy channel. I think they make fun of him a lot. He had just, when we were going through this process, we thought it was going to be between the tribal child welfare agencies and the state child welfare agencies, and Denise was the one that said, no, we need to bring this up. We need to bring this up a level. This has to be between the state government and the tribal governments. And at the time, the governor was Baldacci, who wasn't a real friend to Indian people, even though he was a Democrat. We talked with him, and he didn't even get to talk to him. We couldn't even talk to him. But one thing he did do is when he got termed out and LePage got elected, Baldacci sent a letter to him encouraging him to sign it, because we thought we'd need a miracle to get a Tea Party governor to sign this mandate. And it turns out all we need to do is get him to meet Dee Dee. No. No, she actually met him and spoke with him. And at this signing ceremony, the organizers, me and this other man, we had access to all of the speeches of the signatories because we wanted to make sure we had a nice, well-rounded presentation. So I knew what Governor LePage's speech was supposed to be. And when he started speaking and going off his script, I think everybody was getting nervous because he doesn't do well talking off the top of his head. But what he said off script was, I still say it's the most profound thing I've ever heard him say. And he talked from the heart. And he said he was 12 years old when he was forcibly pushed out of his family. He was kicked out as a child. He was homeless in the streets of Lewiston, Maine. But he said, even though I couldn't be with my family, he said, I was with people who spoke my language and who knew my ways and who looked like me. He said, and Native children didn't have that. So on that level, he understood it. The things he's done since then, you know, are kind of confusing, but he did sign it, and it was history. All right, so you guys want to share some? They're going to share some of their memories of our process.
I remember when I got a call to if I would be willing to tell my story about being in child welfare. I'd been working for the American Friends Service for about 7 years, and I always said yes to everything. I didn't know how to say no. I didn't even know what I was going to do. I didn't know what they were talking about. But one of the women there knew that I had been in foster care, so she knew to ask me. And when I showed up, Penthea was there. Penny Burns is what we used to call her when she was younger. And I just started telling this story that I didn't even know I had. I had never spoke about it to anybody. I have six sisters. I had never spoke to them. I had never spoken to my mother or anybody about my story. And here I was being videotaped and telling this story. And I was telling it very calmly. And I remember the one piece that got to me the most that every time we did a training, I would cry. I remember when my son, and you know, this is that intergenerational trauma. I remember when my son turned a certain age, and was turning from a child into a teenager, and he came into the bedroom, and he came to hug me and kiss me goodnight, and I pushed him away. And I'll never forget the look on that little boy's face, ever. It, at the time, to me, it meant nothing. But as I told my story, and that came out, and we did the trainings, I had to watch that video 5 times within several weeks. I ended up at the last training, my bag was packed and I ended up in a lockdown facility because I was suicidal. I had been going on my merry way before that. I didn't know that anything was wrong with me. I thought I was perfectly fine. And that was the turning point for me. I was asked to join the group. I remember when I went into the room, I felt like this little child again in this room with all these monsters who had taken me, and I hated them. I did not like them at all. I didn't want to work with them. I would give them dirty looks. I used to say the word racism all the time because they hated it. And I always bring up racism. And it wasn't until we did what Esther talked about in the dyads, and I ended up with the woman I hated the most. And after that, I had so much love and compassion for that woman after 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Since then, and going through this process with the Truth and Reconciliation, you know, we had a lot of questions and a lot of concerns about what we were going to call it, what we were going to do, what are we reconciling, can there be forgiveness without reconciliation, can there be reconciliation without forgiveness. We had all those discussions. For me personally, just for me, I have forgiven what was done to me. But what I have reconciled is inside of me. I went from talking about and working around issues of what happened to me to understanding that I, in turn, did things that I was ashamed of and that I was guilty of. And there were things that I didn't do that I should have done. And I had to reconcile that within myself. And then I had to go and make amends and reconcile that with my children. And I did that. My oldest son, the one I talked about, who I pushed away, one day I went into his house, and he's an alcoholic. he abandoned his children. He's been in prison. He tried to hang himself. Right now, he's 38 years old, I believe. I went into his house, and he's sitting in the dark. He had no electricity. He's drinking a cup of coffee and smoking a cigarette. And I said, honey, I want to ask you a question. I said, when you were young, did I beat you? I didn't remember if I... My daughter kept bringing it up, but he said something in it. It just triggered something in me. And he said, Mom, how can you not remember? And I said, well, I need you to tell me what I did to you. And he sat there, and he told me everything. And he cried, and he cried, and he cried. And I was crying, and I was trying not to cry over him because I didn't want him to stop. I wanted him to keep going. And I said, honey, there isn't anything in this world that I could ever, ever do to make up for what I did to you. And he said, yes, Mom, there is. And I thought he was going to say, you could buy me a car or something like that. And I said, what? And he said, you can be my mother, and you can stop being angry with me. He says, I know I'm making mistakes, but I'm a grown man. They're my mistakes. What happened is over. He says, you've made your amends to me so many times in the past. He says, but I just want you to be my mom. That totally changed our relationship. And right now, my son has been sober for 3 weeks. Him and I talk every day. I hug him every day and tell him how much I love him. While I was here, he sent me a text to say, Mom, I miss you, and I love you. And I have also, for the first time in my life, talked to my own mother about what happened. And I never thought I could ever do that. She's 80 years old, but I've spent the last 6 weeks taking care of her, and we talked about what happened to her father, what her father did to her, and what she did to me, and what I did to my children. And now I have 6 incredibly beautiful grandchildren. And when Kisitanamoke was talking, I have a 4-5-month-old grandson whose universe was in the womb for 9 months and is now no longer in that safe universe. And I don't want to happen to him what happened to my mother, what happened to me, or what happened to my son, or my other children. This process for me has been a personal healing process for me, for my family, for my community. There are so many things that have taken place as a result of this. We thought we were doing one simple little thing. We never thought that we were going to be doing anything that would be so life-changing. And a lot of things have come from this in our communities just because of this one piece of work. This isn't going to change the world, but it changed my life and it changed many lives. And for me, if I had to do it over again, somebody asked me once, because it's been really difficult to me. I've been in a lockdown institution several times, not just that one time. And it isn't just because of being in the welfare system. There's things that happened to me also when I was a teenager. They said, would you do it again? And I said, I have 2 choices. I would either not do it again and not know how to love and hug and hold my children and feel anything in my heart for them, or I would go through the pain and the agony and the horrible, horrible, horrible feelings and do it again over and over and over if I have to. I would. I absolutely would. It was worth it. That's all I have. Where'd Penny go?
Oh. So can you tell one more story?
Sure.
We were at this event.
We were at an event at the Augusta State House, and Denise and I had to speak, and this lady stood up. She must have been in her 70s. She needed help getting up. She had a cane. And she stood there in front of everybody, and she looked at us, and she asked for forgiveness because she was one of those caseworkers. Do you want me to tell the story, or you want to tell it? And so we didn't, I mean, we were just, I didn't know what to say. You know, I didn't know what to say to her except to like hold that space for her so she could have those feelings so public in front of everyone. And right after we got done, Denise went over to her. She never met her before. It wasn't Dee Dee's caseworker. And she held her hands, and I'm going to start crying. And she put her forehead to that woman's forehead. They just held each other and cried. And it was all caught on film, too, somewhere. But it was quite a moment of, to see the resiliency of our people and what can happen when we move from here to here. When we do the work that we do and we educate Native people and non-Native people about history, we don't know the history any better than anyone else because it's, by design that it's repressed and we're not supposed to know it. One message that I always try to give Wabanaki people is that, none of this is our fault. Like Rebecca was talking yesterday about our highest rates of socioeconomic distress, and it's easy. I know it's easy to think that there's something wrong with us because I did the same thing. Here I am in college and wondering why I always needed extensions on my papers and why I was always turning things in late and none of my classmates, they could get everything done. They didn't have to take anybody to dialysis 3 times a week. They didn't have to bail anybody out from jail. They didn't. So it's easy to think there's something wrong with you. And what I, that's the message I try to give. And that display that Denise, that compassion she showed that woman that day in the State House shows that, we talk about intergenerational trauma, but that strength and that resiliency in knowing who we are and who we're supposed to be. One of the, Wabanaki people, our culture, our strongly held cultural values are around generosity and graciousness and reciprocity. It's been our salvation and it's been our, contributed to our ruin. When those French settlers came down the St. Croix River and they camped out in an island in the middle of the winter and most of them died, it was our ancestors that went over there and took care of them. So, and that reciprocity, I think it's taken us a while to have enough, especially with the state of Maine. This year we finally, we pulled our two, we've had representatives in the state legislature, the Passamaquoddies and Penobscot since the 1800s, and we pulled them out this summer, this spring, just a couple months ago. And because of that value of reciprocity wasn't being upheld by them and we had enough. It takes a lot for us to walk away from the table. I'm gonna just keep Gavin. Penn's gonna get us back on track.
I guess a couple of things I wanna say about where we started. One is we work together and we're trying to create technical solutions to the problems that were occurring. And some of those technical solutions were indeed very helpful. But as Esther said, the undercurrent underneath the systemic problems were not technical problems. hence the process. And the other thing that when we did the training, the evaluations from the training that first year and the years after had all these, sort of the positive comments. And sometimes verbatim, the same comment across all the years were something to the effect of, it's not my fault, I didn't do that. And so we've come to know now the importance of really understanding the truth for both of those kinds of things, that the technical solutions are just not enough. But that deep understanding to understand what history is the and how history is today is part of the pathway forward. the work that we're doing from this point on is to reconstitute what we call the Indian Child Welfare Work Group with tribal and state child welfare representatives as part of that. Esther will be coordinating that. And to think about how do we bring different people to the table so that we don't simply just look at the system. We started out looking at child welfare. How do we make an improvement in child welfare? We were in this narrow little world of child welfare. And that as the process went forward, we understood that this is related to everything that happened, and the cultural context within which we all live. And so if most of our work will be focused in that area, and then everything else will come along, right? That, you know, the broader system, social system, can help influence improvements in child welfare if we're really reaching people in their hearts. And so the Indian Child Welfare Work Group will reconvene. We'll strive to have specialists in each office to make improvements. Again, looking at some technical solutions, but one of the recommendations from the commission is how do we have training that goes far beyond just technical solutions, but really help to convey some of the broader issues. Were you going to say something?
I was going to say that I don't know if we made it clear that those recommendations that the commission has issued, Maine Wabanaki Reach is responsible for ensuring that they're considered and implemented. That's why my hair stood up when they said respect tribal sovereignty. I'm like, how are we going to get the state to do that? But as you saw on the last slide of the commission's presentation, it's a collective responsibility. You want to say something, Dave?
Don't get us wrong. It's not as if when we started working together, we were all equal. We were never equal. We still are not equal. All the white privilege that the non-natives brought into the room remained in the room. And we talked about it, we worked around it, we tried to find ways to best work, knowing that that white privilege that those people had, that Penn has, is not going to go away. That the things that they enjoy today are at the expense and at the death and the genocide of our people, and that the land that they live on, that they occupy, is at the death and the genocide of our people. So that was always in the room, and we were always aware of it, but we always paid attention to it. So it wasn't always hunky-dory, happy, go lucky, kumbaya.
Nope.
And it probably won't be again. We've been through quite a lot together. So Maine Wabanaki's Reach's work moving forward, we're focused on three major areas, and one of them is child welfare, as Penn talked about. Our next very, very big piece of our work is healing within both Maine and Wabanaki communities. And what that looks like in Wabanaki communities, we're very committed to building trauma resiliency. And there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of really good things going on in our tribal communities. A lot of good work. In our community last summer, the women got together and formed this group, and they wanted to do something about the high rates of youth substance abuse. So they got the community together and they constructed a longhouse because we have an alternative, a place where we can gather. And practice who we are. We do a lot of education of history and trauma and its impacts. We offer contradictions to that trauma. We still know who we are, and we still know how to take care of each other, and that's very evident in, especially in my community in Zabayak, Denise and I, our community, when somebody is in need, somebody gets a health diagnosis and they need a fundraiser. But there's a fundraiser just about every weekend. I mean, it's sad on the one hand that we have to do these fundraisers to help people, but on the other hand, you can see how the community comes together all the time and how you can take care of each other. We have Wabanaki people working in Wabanaki communities as community organizers, very part-time. They do this education, they visit people, they support people, they do outreach. It was our job during this TRC's mandate was we were very clear in the mandate when we wrote it that the TRC would come into our tribal communities when they were invited and in a manner that was directed by that community. And we facilitated that through the Wabanaki organizers. And it changed. Every community was different. The numbers of people they could bring, in two communities, it could only bring the five commissioners and the director. In other communities, they were more open and they wanted more people there. And it was, you know, those were some of the times where we really had to do some work with each other, between the commission and REACH, some real difficult, hard conversations, and where that white privilege was very evident, was at those points where we were going to stand strong and uphold this mandate. And we did that deliberately because we knew there was so much mistrust of anybody, especially anyone that's connected to the state. And I'm very proud of that we put that in there and had that foresight. We're working within our tribal school systems to incorporate more education about history, accurate education about history, and offer healing activities for young people in our schools. Rebecca mentioned yesterday that there's a Maine law that mandates teachers to teach Wabanaki history and culture. There's not a mechanism to enforce that, and teachers don't have a lot of resources to know what to teach. So we are working with a lot of allies within the state of Maine, some different colleges, to develop those Teach the Teacher workshops, or to give them something that they can teach in their schools. We are very invested in welcoming our people home, whether they were taken by force, by foster care or adoption, whether they were taken by these relocation acts, you know, that sent all our people to the cities to disperse us, or whether they were taken through the correction system. Passamaquoddy men in Maine, I think, have the highest rate of incarceration. We have so many incarcerated relatives, and we got a little bit of funding to give prisoners, Wabanaki prisoners, the opportunity to share a statement. And that has opened up our work in such wonderful directions. We're focused, we're doing healing circles in the prisons. We have Wabanaki people leading those circles in the prisons. We are really focused on reentry. We visited the Southern Maine Reentry Center, Maria, our colleague, and I, and we were looking around. We said, we're going to have one of these. We're going to open a reentry center for Wabanaki people. I couldn't believe how simple it was and how we can do this. We're also working on welcoming our people home through having ceremonies at our annual Indian Day gatherings and trying to find our lost relatives. And that's going to be hard because we don't know where they all are. As the commission, the statement gathering process is over, but we are committed to making sure that there's still a way for Maine and Wabanaki people to contribute a statement to that archive, that 152 statements that the commission has. We're developing a process working with Bowdoin College, who's holding the archives, and not only just, okay, come and give you a statement, but help prepare people and support them through that process. Our organizers hold healing circles in our communities. We're very focused on sovereignty in the way that we view it, which is reclaiming our traditions and our rituals, those things that have enabled us to survive. You know, four or five tribes have survived and those other 20-something Wabanaki tribes didn't. Why? Because we have intergenerational strengths. And we ask elders what has helped us to survive, and they say our sense of humor. So it's and so our view of sovereignty is taking care of our own people in the way that we see fit. So to that end, we are working a lot as food as medicine and food sovereignty, revitalizing Wabanaki traditions of birth and coming of age. Gizitonamook's wife, Migamahan, has been very helpful in helping us learn our traditions. She's Mi'kmaq from Canada. So when we think about sovereignty, the way we come into this world and the way we leave this world, we have complete control over that, and we can reclaim that. The funeral home that's next to my community holds our bodies hostage until we can pay the full amount. So there's a, you know, the elders and Denise's mother's age and my mother, my mother's 80 as well, and she's not physically well. And when she was so happy when she saw the longhouse built, she said, "Finally, I have a place." She doesn't want to be anywhere near the church. She has a place where we can have a ceremony, because we don't have any facility, no house like that. If you don't want the church, you don't really have any alternative. And she's so happy. She's like, "That's where I want to be waked, at the longhouse." And you know, her cousin Lane, same thing. He built a pine. What do you call them? Coffins. And that coffin's been used for 3 or 4 deaths already. Because it doesn't. You know, how much do you pay for a casket from the funeral home industry? And that other people are also seeing the environmental impact of the way funeral homes bury people. So we're slowly, we have a death chant that only one Passamaquoddy woman knows. So we're working with her to learn that chant so we can start reclaiming all of that. And that the work that we're doing goes along with the commission's recommendation for that cultural renaissance that they talked about. And then Penn's gonna talk about ally building.
What we now call ally building began as people wanted to volunteer in the Truth Commission process, and we created a process to figure out how folks could be involved with that. But very quickly found that people wanted to deepen their learning and understanding and be part of significant change. And so we really shifted from thinking about this as volunteering to figuring out how to act as an ally, how to take responsibility for our own learning as non-Native people, and to create a kind of collaboration and relationship with one another to act in ways that promote change and promote change in a way where we are gaining awareness of our privilege and how we can be in relationship in a different kind of way. So we do a few different things through the community education events. People become involved. We do some training events for people to become more involved as allies and ongoing groups, and then have translated this into how to work with our Wabanaki brothers and sisters to figure out how to take actions. Whether it is being involved in a rally, a political event. We have people who have become allies who write op-eds or letters to the editor, become a visible voice, will attend legislative hearings on matters that are of importance to Wabanaki people with guidance from Wabanaki people about what their wishes are. And sometimes the people are just are sitting there being a presence. We all, at this one particular hearing, everybody had a pin on that said, "I support Wabanaki sovereignty." And some people never got up to speak, but just sat, but was a presence there, and that's what they could offer. Other people delivered testimony and then afterwards called their own legislator or wrote their own legislator to be a voice in support of Wabanaki people. we have a variety of things that we are planning in that kind of way to maintain visibility in non-Native communities that has just not been there, there are still people who live in the state of Maine who say we have Native tribes here in Maine. And so to maintain some of that visibility, working with the Humanities Council to set up a reading series with Native authors. Sandy, I think I met with a woman from the Humanities Council the other day, and she talked about her connection with you and some suggestions that you had with that, setting up a speaker series that we would have. So in different parts of the state of Maine, every month there would be something going on that can create visibility, deepen understanding, be another source of education, in addition to the events that we're doing. But how do we invest other organizations in the state to be part of helping to maintain and grow the visibility. So that, and I think as Esther said it, is as we are doing this, we who are non-Native people, we're deepening our own understanding about what it is that we're organizing and setting up and growing our own learning in the process as well.
So I just want to give you a little background of these photos you see up here. The legislative hearing down here on the left, it was a hearing before our representatives pulled out. One of them presented some piece of legislation around the Violence Against Women Act. So what's important to know is that Passamaquoddy and Penobscots, since we have this Maine Claim Settlement Act that was passed in 1980, one of the things it states is that any federal legislation that's passed after 1980 that doesn't specifically name Passamaquoddy and Penobscot, Mi'kmaq, Maliseet will not apply to them. So the Game and Rights Act did not apply to us. So we need to get state approval to have gaming. The Violence Against Women Act does not apply to us. So right now in Passamaquoddy and Penobscot, we have tribal court, and if a non-tribal member assaults somebody in our community, we can't prosecute them. So there was a bill in front of the legislature asking the Attorney General to, she can make an exception. All she has to do is sign something, and we can enforce VAWA in our communities. At this hearing, there were over 50 people provide testimony, and they weren't all Native people. There was a lot of, you know, domestic violence advocates around the state. Every piece of testimony was in favor of passing this VAWA. The Attorney General did not show up to that hearing. Instead, there was a work session the next week. She showed up at the work session and didn't have any real reason why she didn't want this to pass. So they did the worst thing that they could do. I mean, if they had killed the bill, it would give us some, you know, political momentum. If they had passed it, that would have been great. They, what do they call that? They tabled it to next session. So that just give you an idea of what it's like to be a Native person in the state of Maine. And the picture on up in the right-hand corner is an event that happened last weekend on Indian Island. The Penobscot Nation is involved in probably the most important legal battle that they will ever, I don't know if Rebecca and Darren would agree with me, that they will ever face. They got a letter in 2012 from the Attorney General saying that the Penobscots don't have any right to the Penobscot River. Do you agree with the statement? And of course they didn't, so their only recourse was to sue the Attorney General's office. The Department of the Interior has joined the Penobscots in their suit. And it's amazing that most of the state of Maine does not know that their Attorney General has done this. And the organizers around this river case at Penobscot have done a real good job of educating. And you see these people here. This was an event called Justice for the River, where we're bringing the allies together to just celebrate. It was a teach-in. So we learned a lot, and then we celebrated this allyship. One of the things that happened in this case is an attorney went up and down the river and got, I think, maybe 16 towns to sign on as interveners in this case, you know, towns that aren't even near Penobscot Nation. And one of those towns was Orono, which is the next town up. And allies in Orono got the Orono Town Council to withdraw from that suit. It might sound like a little thing, but it's a big deal. And this picture down here on the right, that was the day that tribes pulled the legislators out of the hearing. And an example of the power of allies is when the our tribal representatives read the statement that they were leaving, a lot of their fellow legislators walked out with them. So many that they couldn't hold the session that day because they didn't have a quorum. So that was, you know, it might have been just a little, you know, but for them it was a big deal for them to walk out with the tribal legislators. So that's another example of allyship and how we need allies and we need allies that know the history and allies that have done that reflective work. We don't need what Charlotte had talked about, the voyeurs, to just come in to be voyeurs, you know. Like Maria says, it's not a spectator sport. So we just got one. This is us, one of our, we've grown. That was one of our quarterly meetings with the TRC. because Atonewook looks so comfortable, doesn't he? We're going to miss them, but they're still going to be involved, I'm pretty sure. And talk about Red Hope. This is dawn at Zibayik. That was the morning of the sacred fire ceremony we had to welcome the commission into our community on one cold November morning. So I think now would probably be a good time if people had questions for either us or Sandy and Gizitonamuk and Charlotte, anything about the process. I mean, there's so many stories to tell that we could be here all day.
I guess my question is, you know, through your efforts, you know, is there more of a network that's growing, you know, on how to get the communities active again and like community events and things like that?
Yes. One thing that has happened, our tribal leaders have these tribal leaders meetings where they get together and they've been inviting people from Reach to come. And to have our input and to, you know, give us direction, but we're kind of working together and collaborating. That whole rally at the State House we helped organize that because, you know, we have connections. We have Wabanaki people that are connecting with people in all the communities. So I see that happening more. It's especially now that the TRC has completed their mandate, the focus is turning back to Reach and what we can do and to organize in our communities and bring people together.
Oh yeah, the wellness gap.
As a result of the TRC in my community, a couple of years ago, the Tribal Council passed a resolution authorizing a restorative justice and healing commission made up of every single department within the tribe. They mandated that every department head participate in a monthly meeting where we would work together with each other so that we could heal with each other in order to heal the rest of our community and to provide services and to reconnect and to work with each other to make sure we provided better services to our community. And that's been going on for 2 years. And since we started it, we've gotten allies from the legal community. We've gotten representatives from the Penobscot Nation, from the Mi'kmaq Nation, and it's just grown, and it's been an incredible movement.
The observation or question is that, and just kind of going back to all the communities are trying to deal with, you know, all this trauma and things like that. One thing that we realized is that our people lost their voice. And it was always tribal leader, tribal, you know. And, you know, I'm on the council right now, and part of it is, you know, I'm not your leader. That's not our term, you know. And then we realized that our constitution just took care of the administration, the legislation, and the courts. And what we realize is that the fire for the men hasn't been built in a long time. The fire for the women hasn't been put into action. And we lost that whole aspect of the people. And so, you know, those are the efforts I think that we were trying to go back to, is saying, okay, where's the people? And what it meant for us, and we're still a long ways from it, is that it's our responsibility. Because we kind of turned into that welfare state. Everything goes through the territory down to the people, and that was the way that, you know, that was part of the trauma and things that are going on as we lost our voice. So like the men are looking and saying, We don't care what the nation does. We're gonna start our buffalo farms. We're gonna do it. We're gonna start our lumber mills. We're gonna start all those kind of things. We don't mind if the territory or the nation, so to speak, supports it, but we don't need their legislation. We don't need any of that, because what it does for us is that it gives us a way to, we realize that our men have lost their whole purpose in the community. There's nothing that they can do or for me to do to raise my sons and go and spend time with them and say, and work with them and all those other kinds of things. I go, I get a paycheck, I come home. And so there's nothing in the communities that that makes us, puts us in that position of interacting. And I think that was the, my hope is that, through your efforts and things like that, you don't forget that in order to do this healing you're talking about, that part of building that community and giving them their voice again, and not let it be overridden by the governments, because we in government, we got our egos, and sometimes we just got to step aside and say, not we're voices. We're never meant to be leaders. It was something that we collected a voice of the people.
So when the tribal chiefs signed the mandate, that they were directed by the council to do that, when it came time for the community to prepare for the commission coming into the community, that didn't, the tribal leaders weren't involved in that.
Yeah.
It was the people. It was the people that, and what I would say is, anytime you can get our people to sit together in a circle, is that, to me, that's the start of the work right there. And we encourage that circle work, where in all that we do, and that's how we got people to get together and let you know, do you want the TRC to come here, and how do you want them to come here, and what should we do? I remember when we were working with the commission to set up their visit to Madocmaguk, the elders were real adamant that they spent the night in their homes. Remember that, Sandy?
Yes,
so that was so we worked with them, and that was really, I would say that our tribal governments, they signed the mandate, and then they kind of took a back seat, and we would report to them. REACH would report to our tribal chiefs and councils in our communities. The TRC went and back and connected with all of the chiefs and the councils, but it was just kind of like a touch base and an update, and this is what we're doing. Right. They were real hands off, and actually Governor LePage was too. At one point he got upset and sent out this press release saying that he didn't support the TRC anymore. But all of the things that he signed, there's a bulleted list. If you look on their website, you can see the mandate they signed. There's a bulleted list of things that they said that they would do, and he kept doing all of them. Right. So it was just for show, because the process was bigger than them, and it did belong with the people, and that's how it happened. Last fall, we held a wellness gathering for Wabanaki people, where we brought people together and explored. We did a lot of art and healing. We did theater work. We talked about food as medicine. We sang that, we had the woman come from township to sing the death chant, so we could learn that from her. And so it's just, and that, it was this, a lot of work putting this gathering together, getting everybody there, but it was just, it's just the first step.
Right.
We're gonna do it every year to get people together to keep things. It takes a lot of times to think about these things and revisit them before they take hold. And so we just keep at it.
I want to offer up my wife as a contact here for only because, it's one of the reasons why I say that is that we have a, and she's in charge of, not in charge, she's one of the people that help pull the Food is Our Medicine together in our community. And what we're realizing is that it's not just in our communities, is that that's how we as people related to the other people in the other territories. It's turned from nation leader to nation leader, leadership talk to leadership, and we haven't rebuilt the mechanisms that our people get together and share, the basket making, the arts, but the foods and all those other kinds of things where we talk about taking care of ourselves. And, you know, and the one thing that we also realize with it is that, again, it's building that purpose for the people and that responsibility for them to give back into their community. So yeah. we're hoping that we can start storing, just for practice, 7 years of white corn, you know, and then work off from those kinds of things and then start trading with other territories and seeing what they have in order to trade back and, again, keep it more within the communities and not so much with the leadership. But the last thing I think I want to just say is that, you know, the other thing that when it gets down to the trauma is that what we're trying to realize is that it goes back to the men, because that's what I'm dealing with, is that I realized that we weren't developing men anymore. You know, our boys and our males were growing older, but they weren't turning into men. And that's why we need to build those things back in and that purpose for the men in our community, because we need to show them how to be men and be responsible. And it's going to be done different than there's that point, and so we're going back to rites of passage, that point when the young male, he goes to the men, because we also realize is that our men, and it's not to fault the women or our boys, there's too many of them being raised by females, and they're not learning what they need to learn as a man, and their place, their responsibility about taking care of the family and those other kinds of things. And for a man, for me, for my boys, it's like, you know, I'm not saying their mother or their grandmother is softer. It's that, you know, I can look at them a little different and say, look, get off your ass. You know, let's get responsible. Knock it off. You know, and not say, well, you know, it's okay. I'm going to give you time. You know, they get enough of that, is what I'm saying. And so there's that balance that we have to get. But it's that rites of passage with the girls, too. Nobody understands that, you know, when do they go and understand their position? We don't do that anymore. They don't go with their older sisters to learn how to, you know, take care and raise children. And even that aspect of having sex and kids isn't explained to everybody. It's this big secret. Because it's never taught about the responsibility that... and why you're going to do this, and that you better be ready because it's going to change your life forever. Those are the conversations that are left out of our community, but that's the kind of stuff I think we want to kind of talk, you know, community members again and say, okay, how did you guys do it? What can we borrow from you? Because we need to recreate it again as kind of a national network, you know, and share what works and doesn't work. So.
Yeah, I know... Mi'kmahan, my girls, there was a, when they were coming of age, there were 8 of them, and they were all close, and she came and met with the mothers and the girls, and we went through, you know, 2 years of ceremony for them, and learned so much, and those girls now, I mean, they're 20 now, and they're still, there's something different about their relationship still, you know, together, and they have that strength from that experience of being in the ceremony together.
Mine is just a comment about the group. I always forgot the names in order. You know, I thought there was a convening group and there was a. But I think the part that I want to just bring back to as an example of hanging in there and doing work was the length of time that this group was meeting prior to the TRC being thought of and then planned. Has been like 99, right? Yeah. 99, it's 2015. So one of the things that most impressed me when I would go out there to have meetings with REACH was that people from DHHS were part of that, ever, some of them since 99, and they've had few changes, but for the most part, this group has met that long. That's a long time in Indian country, or even in general. to just stay there and hammer out and figure out, and as they said, the conversations that they had to have with each other to be able to stay there, it was a real commitment. And you could see that when we would go in and meet with them on as commissioners, report and listen and hear them. So that's like so commendable, it's like beyond commendable. That just doesn't happen. So it says a lot about who they are, and it says a lot about their commitment. It says a lot about where they went to get the support to stay there. Because any of you who do work, intercultural, it's very difficult. It's exceptionally difficult. So that's amazing. And then the other part that I wanted to mention, I think Charlotte can explain this better, is that I didn't know this part, but there have been other truth commissions throughout the country or throughout the world. But the fact that we finished and have a mandate, would you just explain what you told me, Charlotte, about that? I think that's also says a lot about the work that was committed to hanging in there and doing it, even though it got exceptionally difficult at times.
One of the things that I was really struck by when I was doing a little research on Truth and Reconciliation Commissions is that the majority of them fail. They don't finish. That people get discouraged, people run out of funds. Sometimes what happens is commissioners disagree with findings and they pull out and people pull back. But in some cases, it looks like up to 50% of truth commissions, like 50% of marriages in this country, fail. So we did not, and for lots of different reasons. But I think that Reach's example of tenacity, and fierceness, and commitment, and open-heartedness was incredibly inspiring. So that was amazing. That was amazing. I didn't really sort of take that in until we were sort of at the end of the process of, wow, we actually produced our report. We were in agreement as a commission. We really held strongly to our findings, and we worked with at the highest possible integrity that we could summon.
I want one last comment about that. I think the other reason that made this TRC gave it the energy that we had is we had in the beginning people from another TRC in the United States with another topic come and share with us of this is how we did it, this is what we wanted, suggest you do. And I remember sitting in that meeting going, yeah, but we're Indians. And every time they'd say something, I'd go, but yeah, but we're Indians. And so every once in a while I would say it, not every time, but a lot of times. And I didn't want to hurt their feelings because they did finish theirs, I believe.
Greensboro
did not. Oh, that's right. That's right, because they said you guys are going to fight and you guys got to separate.
They said at the end.
Yep.
That they pulled out.
Yeah, they finished. They said they had to. We had to separate ourselves from the convening committee, that all this stuff. And I kept thinking, but that's not how Indians work. We work much better when we're together, and sure, we have some boundaries of our expectation of what we're supposed to deliver, but how can I, as a commissioner, come into an Indian community without permission, number one, and without telling us how they want us to be, number two, because I'm Indian, but I'm not Wabanaki, so we had to be bold and say, we're going to indigenize our process. We're going to do it the way we know will work best. And we relied on Reach. Reach relied on us. The only time we kind of like went separate was like, we got to write now, back off. And they got nervous because, I'm sure they were wondering, oh my God, are they going to really write what we saw, what we know? And I knew that I didn't have any fear of that. I knew that we would. I knew that we would do it. I had no idea Charlotte was as gifted as she was in terms of writing, but I was so confident because the other piece I forgot to mention, what made us different because we're Indigenous, is the prayer that went into every step of the way. I couldn't have picked better commissioners to work with, and the integrity and commitment that our commissioners who aren't with us have. Matt Dunlap, Secretary of State of Maine, Carol Wishcamper, who's been an activist in philanthropy for years, and the director of the social work department in Maine, who always talked about how she had to, she's been in the process of undoing the harm that she had done in the previous years as a professor of social work and stuff. So the five of us came from all these different, very, very different backgrounds and very, very aware of what we did had and what we didn't have. So when it was time for someone to really speak on behalf of white people or to a larger audience of white people addressing something, the perfect person for that would be Matt. And they would listen to him differently than they would listen to us. And other times it would be Gissy Tanamook or myself, or it would be Carol, who understood organizational thing like we didn't and could explain it in a way that was makes so much sense. And Gail, who would always bring her experience as a professor and the educational process of social work and how we can change that. So we did indigenize our process. We did do it the way we wanted to do it. And I'm really glad we did, because look what's happened as a result. But anyway.
Just before Rebecca, no, I don't need this. I just wanted to bring to the attention that we do have copies of the report, right?
I hope there are enough for everybody, but if they're not, please let me know. If you want a physical copy, I'm more than happy to send you one. You can also find it online and download a PDF, if that would be of interest to people. But I've got a bunch of them right up here.
If I could make a suggestion based on a couple of decades of thinking about the situation of our relatives in Maine and my experience as the lead lobbyist on the Maine Land Claim Settlement Act of 1980, now would be a good time, because of the United States position on the river issue and in litigation, for the nations in Maine to ask for meetings with the White House and with the Justice Department to reestablish nation-to-nation relationships that were torn apart and damaged and trampled on and overlooked to such an extent that the steering committee for the Maine Land Claim Settlement Act, to a person, and there were 26 of them, said, we do not want a relationship with the federal government. We want state jurisdiction. And some of us argued totally against that, saying, you know, the states, even John Marshall said, the states are the deadliest enemies of the Indians, and this is not a good way to go. State jurisdiction is not. While you can establish that relationship fully with the United States. And they said no. And they went for state jurisdiction, which, and now we see the consequences of that. And also there were Native nations and peoples in Maine who were left out of the Settlement Act. I mean, some of you are sitting here. You're the living evidence of that. And so now, while you have a guarantee of the same administration that's been going in a good direction, would be a good time to open that dialogue and try to get something that would codify that relationship, even at this late date. And I think that the door in is through VAWA, because you're talking about a jurisdictional law enforcement the gap and make the same arguments that were made for when everyone got VAWA passed on the basis of inherent sovereignty. Inherent sovereignty. So that would be the thing to stress. And I would be happy to, you know, talk with people who want to try that and give whatever help I could on the same pro bono basis as I did initially, and hope with a different outcome. I mean, I was doing the bidding and in the service of the steering committee, which it wasn't just their notion. They would go back and have meetings with people, but they didn't, you know, just the nature of it, not all the people were included. So no one can be faulted for positions they took, because to get to the Settlement Act, they had to sue the BIA, which was saying, we're not going to investigate your land claim. We don't owe a trust responsibility to anyone east of the Mississippi. I mean, that's what they were saying as late as the early 1970s. And Judge Janoux in Maine, the federal district court judge, said, what? What kind of fiction is this? Of course you have an obligation to investigate. So he ordered them to investigate. They investigated and said, oh, this is a good land claim. And then turned it over to the solicitor's office, and they investigated, said, this is a good land claim. They turned it over to justice. They investigated, said, this is a good land claim, and that's what became U.S. v. Maine in 1976. So it took the 60s, well, the 50s, the 60s, and up until that decision in 1976 to get the federal government to acknowledge that some of the Indians in Maine had a relationship with them. And it had nothing to do with whether or not you were on one side or the other of this body of water. So I just give that to you for historical perspective and an urging to take advantage of this time. So thank you.
That's an exceptional offer. I just want to very briefly acknowledge the process in which I am feeling in my just initial perusal of the report, that the approach that you took is wholly consistent with our ways of being as Wabanaki people. And I think it's oftentimes masked in that grassroots or, you know, and it's actually like that story of Dee Dee engaging with that 70-year-old woman, like that is who we really are. And that process in which you engaged in is who we really are too. So it's, I just want to acknowledge the Wabanaki epistemology that was engaged with as I'm, you know, hearing about, and I felt through, you know, the experience even 4,000 miles away that whatever other TRCs did, it's not a TRC contest, we know that, right? But I think what distinguishes this TRC process is what people are identifying as being, you know, grassroots, when I would say it transcends that, in that it's wholly consistent in alignment with the ways and knowing and being of our people and our ancestors. So, you know, I just really like love and honor to hear everything that you've compromised and sacrificed and contributed for the sake of our people. So.
Echo that, Rebecca. Just some other features and details that people might not be aware of. When one of the issues at first when people were coming forward is that they were often concerned about speaking one-on-one with somebody. And we realized we had to alter our process a little bit, and people had wanted to speak in groups. And so we developed a focus group modality. It was a circle modality. People met in circle, and they spoke about a lot of different topics. There was a Wabanaki elder group in which a lot of Passamaquoddy was spoken and has been translated by a native Passamaquoddy person. People were given the option to speak in a native language if they wanted to. Everybody decided to speak in English, but we were very conscious of the fact that we were using the colonizing language in order to capture these stories, and had we been listening in native languages, we would have held and heard something very, very different, but people were given that option. We used iPads, which were sort of small and quieter. People could choose whether they wanted to have an audio or a video. One of the funny pieces was everybody 30 and under chose the video. Everybody 30 and older chose the audio. Nobody, older folks didn't, I would have done the same thing, didn't want to be included and have their pictures included. And people had a lot of choice in the process, so that if they wanted to add something, they wanted to retract something, they could do that. And the same went into the archiving process. But more than 90% of the people involved chose to have their statements transferred to the archive at Bowdoin College, which will remain an open archive. People can continue to add statements to it. The conversation is ongoing. But more than 90% of people chose to have those statements transferred and to have them publicly accessible. And when we asked people, we really explained, this means someone can go online and find your story. And they said, we know, we really understand that. And we said, are you sure? And they said, yes, because we don't want this to happen again. So it was a very, we really tried to keep the process in people's hands and to bring whatever we could to make people feel comfortable. We offered tobacco. Tobacco was held. People, if they wanted to smudge beforehand or after, they could. We gathered all the tissues that people that cried on, and there were a lot of tears, and we held on to every single one of them. And they were burned in ceremony at the closing ceremony and held in prayer as that process was shutting down. And then dancing spontaneously occurred in that process as well. I think there's probably a lot more we could have done to further indigenize the process. I think there probably would be. But we did do what we could with the time that we had.
You didn't have to, because it was already indigenous.
Oh yeah, that's right. No, exactly.
Indigenized is like, it was already so inherent. Point is, it was already so inherently indigenous, you know, and I think that's going to be like, that's something to hang on to.
Right.
Anyhow, it's really, thank you for that. It's really hopeful.
Not that the white people in the commission were directing that at all, but we were responding. We were really trying to listen. My point is, we were trying to listen as much as possible to what was there.
One short comment that people might be wondering about is, we as commissioners were not paid for our time. I got flown out and I got a hotel, but
Fry bread.
Well, yes. Whenever we got to go to Indian Township, we got to hang out at Esther's house, which was my favorite thing to do because she's an awesome cook. In fact, my husband didn't want to come to the closing ceremony because Esther wasn't cooking. No. But and see, that's what I mean by indigenizing it. We ate in people's houses. That, you know, we were that. But I wanted to make that note that we were not paid for our time. That was all volunteer time, which we were willing to do. I remember when they said, you're chosen, but are you willing to do up to 10 days being gone at a time? And having traveled with Chris, I'm used to being gone 21 days at a time. So yeah, I said, yeah, I can do that if I need to.
He did. It was a long
story. This is just in some ways reiterating what Rebecca said. And I do want to thank the people who have been doing this work for so many years. It's really, it's been really transformative in the state, and sort of relationship, and us thinking about the relationships between us as Native people and other people in the state. So what I think is actually a real strong expression of Indigenous sovereignty and has changed, I think, the discussion in the state, which the relationships seem bad with the official levels, but I think they've they've been starting to transform at other levels because of the introduction or reintroduction of the notion of ally building that Wabanaki Reach has been has pushed to a whole new level, I think, and that's we're witnessing that. It's affecting things like Penobscot Nation. We drafted water quality standards, and we've invited in people from outside our community to actually comment on our water quality standards. I don't think that would have happened without the presence of what ally building has been happening with Wabanaki Reach. So in some ways, there are similar people involved. Maria Gerard, who's not here, who's a real masterful organizer and ally builder, has been a key part of that work. But I think that our expressions of sovereignty through these relationships is that's who we are, as opposed to, oh, we have juridical, you know, there's that notion of the juridical control pieces of sovereignty, but these are exercising notions of relationship that are true to who we are. And I actually think I see non-Native people responding to that. Like, that you know, when you invite people in to sort of see what you want for waterway, and they're like, well, this is, you know, the state doesn't do, you know, like, you actually do care. You know, like, this is sort of this recognition of our heart and how we feel about our homelands. And I think that as a quote-unquote organizing strategy, it's so much more in our context. And thank you guys so much for doing, you know, you were in the face-to-face, very painful context of doing that work. And I'm, like a lot of other Indigenous citizens in the state, we're going to benefit from this. And I try to support it whenever I can as well.
So I've been trying to think of how to formulate the question. I'm from a national organization that works with child welfare organizations across the country. And I've also, in the last few weeks, been in a number of settings, but around different but linked issues. So I'm wondering how we hold on to the uniqueness of this effort with these specific tribes in this specific state, the way that it was carried out, which is very unique and I think worked because of its uniqueness, and yet use it as a teaching tool beyond the tribes, beyond the states, to get at the same issues that are at the core of child welfare. The issues of the right to the child should come first, right? That the principle around engagement of families and communities, it's unique to the Native American community, but there's remnants of it in every other community. So whether you were forced from these lands or dragged to these lands in chains, or you're trying to get to these lands, the same lack of focus on those principles is true. And I think this is, I've been sitting here saying, how do we take this and use it as a teaching tool without losing the uniqueness of it? Because it worked because it's unique. So I'm just wondering if you've thought about that, if you've thought about how do you go beyond Maine, how do you go beyond Native American, how do you reach into the fact that in cities across this country, there are Native American youth that are disproportionately in the child welfare system, but nobody knows it or talks about it because they're not in concentrated numbers. Now, how do we get at all of that? It's not to lay everything on this conversation, but how do we lift it up and learn from it? And I don't know whether you all have thought about it, or is it something you'd even want to see? I'm imagining I was invited here for a reason, and maybe I'm hoping that that's the reason. It's almost like as an African American sitting in a room and not wanting to say, and also, because of absolute tremendous respect for the differences, but also knowing in this country there are similarities that have to do with racism and all the other isms that exist. So, anyone want to answer?
Well, I think your question is valid to ask how do we address issues that are unique to us and yet set an example. And I think that's what we do. What we're trying to suggest to everybody is that many of the issues that we face have a strong resonance beyond our territories, beyond our peoples. And I think that is our message on everything, whether we're talking about the doctrine of Christian discovery, which isn't unique to us. Obviously, it impacted Africa first. So I think anything that we address, whether it's the protection of our children or violence against women or suicide or any of these environmental issues, we're asking the non-Native community is to stand with us, not for our own benefit, but for your own. There are some real tragic things that this country, that this land and much of the planet are going to face. And what we're saying is that we've existed for tens of thousands of years right here. And we have a history. We have the epigenetics. We have some of that stuff that is embedded in our DNA about not just survival, because survival is not enough. We're talking about living full and thriving lives. There's some bad times coming ahead. And I agree with some of what's been said here. The United States and Canada, I don't think they're our future. But you know what? That doesn't mean as people here that we don't have a future together. So what we're suggesting in everything that we do, including what these folks have done, is that we have some solutions, and it's not just about indigenizing. It's about saying, look, we've been here. We've been here facing a lot of these issues for thousands of years, long before you washed up on our shores or were dragged in chains on our shores. So what we're saying is let's come together on some of these issues. Let's protect each other. And I think that's not about watering down the uniqueness of our circumstance. That's about saying, let us share some lessons.
The main piece of the work that we have done, that we have never forgotten and we have always held deeply, is love and forgiveness. And if we remember love and forgiveness, then there is not anything that we cannot do. We've had our process recorded from the very beginning. And the reason for that is to archive it so that it can be used in other ways and it could be duplicated in other ways in which other places may want to use it. We do travel and make presentations in other places, but if I'm not willing to forgive, then I become like those other people. I become like the perpetrator. And I refuse to do that. I was really struck watching the news recently in what happened in Charleston and all of the forgiveness that the families are showing after that horrible, horrible massacre. And one of the things that really struck me was that they are refusing to allow that which happened to define who they are or to turn them into something that they're not. And that's what we need to hold on to, that as Indigenous people, as nations, we are nations, that we have values and that we have compassion and that we have love and that we have forgiveness. And that's going to carry us through whatever work that we do. There isn't any piece of work that can't be accomplished.
I just wanted to add another thought here. Part of the challenge that we have is language. And we're using a language that doesn't always accurately reflect some of the things that are philosophical to us, cultural to us. And I would include that even a word like forgiveness. You know, in Mohawk, we have a word called skana, or Seneca, this is skano, Kano. Yeah. And when we say it means peace, because that was one of the sentiments expressed when we gathered in the beginning, it doesn't just mean peace. What it means is balance. So it means about restoring balance. So when you thrive for peace, it's not the absence of conflict. Life is conflict. Nature provides conflict. And the reason nature provides conflict is so balance can be achieved. And so when we talk about forgiveness, that's a word that we don't even have that word in our language. What we really are talking about is balance and about restoration of balance. And I think oftentimes we have to kind of sometimes reflect back to understanding that we have to use, I guess, reflect back to our language. So even as we're saying words that are English, that we take a little more time. In Mohawk, our word for love, I was just saying this on our way to the hotel last night, our word for love is actually derived from the husk around the corn. That's where the word comes from, because it talks about protection and nurturing. So when we use words like love and forgiveness, I think we have to sometimes go a little bit back, and it's not I'm not saying it to defy those words, I'm saying it to help define those words.
And I think when we use the word we need to be careful that we are all different nations and that we all have, there are things that are not similar between us, because when I say forgiveness, I mean forgiveness. I don't mean peace. When I say love, I mean love. And I think one of the things that is a misconception is that all Native nations are all the same, that we all have the same philosophies, that we all have the same types of thinking, that we all have the same beliefs. And as Wabanaki people, we are distinct. As a Passamaquoddy, I'm distinct from Rebecca, who is Penobscot, even though we are both Wabanaki. And there are ways that she follows that are distinct from the ways that I follow. So we need to remember that.
What, Bennett?
Can I talk?
Yeah.
Okay.
Of course.
Well, given that I invited you here, I sent the email, and no, I think I left a voicemail, actually.
I think I have a few things.
Yeah. I really wanted you here. But, I mean, no, the reason why Allie and I chose to follow the TRC is in the world of TRCs, of Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which has become kind of this, you know, I don't want to call it a trope model, but that's kind of what it's become in a lot of ways in the peace-building world, is that a state fails, and all of a sudden the international community comes in, implements a Truth and Reconciliation Commission to help one government transition to another, and there's supposed to be peace and reconciliation, and that and truth. And that's what the U.S. has supported abroad. And the model has come back at home. However, no one's really, I mean, I'm sorry, I'm speaking out of my own opinion here, but the South African TRC model, which everyone keeps on basing themselves on, didn't actually put the system of apartheid under scrutiny. It was the perpetrators that were under scrutiny, and also victims that were highlighted, in which everyone all of a sudden became very well known with the TRC model because it was broadcast around the world, without actually understanding that, as Mahmoud Mamdani says, that the apartheid system was never condemned during that Truth and Reconciliation process. The Maine TRC is the only one thus far to actually put the perpetrating system under examination and not only condemn what was done, but try to fix it, which is why this is an unprecedented process. It's the same as in Canada. The colonial state and the churches which perpetrated the TRC process, well, the residential schools, were never actually condemned or fixed. They were left up to themselves to fix, but they were ultimately sued and made to reconcile with themselves. And so this process truly is unprecedented in that way.
So, can I? Esther.
Made me speechless.
So you got me as CEO of the Child Welfare League of America, and I want to say a couple of things about
that.
Yes.
Yes. Did you behave? Yes,
yes. No. And you got me as me, and I need to separate the two, but yet put the two together. So the Child Welfare League of America, about 15 years ago, prior to my coming in, made a sincere apology for its involvement for many years in doing what it thought at the time was the best thing for children, which was removing them and placing them in homes. And I think that that apology has made the organization a stronger organization and a better organization. I came to it without any experience ever in child welfare, with a experience in community work. So I came out of the building communities from the inside out asset type of framework. And from someone who had been very deeply involved in the African-American community around rights for African-Americans and, you know, understanding just the issue of rights. So I think that it is absolutely the responsibility of the Child Welfare League not just to have made an apology some years ago, but to do something about it, to act on it, and to do what it needs to do to move forward. And we haven't done enough. And I think that there's lots more we can do. I don't think any organization has done enough. I also think, though, that there's a whole set of things that are deeply personal to me that we're all talking about. And every single principle has been articulated in some way this morning. I wish I could kind of take this morning and carry it around with me, because I think it'll make me a better CEO. So, and there's connections for each of them. So there's the principle of child rights and the absolute necessity for our country to get it right as it relates to child rights. And that's a connection for the work that you're doing. And we're the only country now that has not adopted the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. It is outrageous for us, but it's a politicized situation, as are most of the things, and I'm sure what you'll talk about later. So the rights of the child. The fact that this issue of safety and neglect is so much around culture and what we know about culture and what we don't know. The workforce that we're dealing with and what they do and don't know and who they are or not and how well they are trained, how well or not they're paid, the trauma that they experience, the trauma that they inflict, all of that is also something that we're all having to deal with. And the fact that the people that we're right now most concerned about are living in a country that has found ways to make us not be who we are. So you can say the tribes are different and make a huge case. The country doesn't see you at this point as individual tribes, right? The same thing with the Latino population. The same thing with the African population in this country that are all Africans, you know, or African Americans. And in fact, that's not true. You know, we're from the Caribbean and we're from Africa and we're very different in our, you know, southern, northern and that type of thing. So there's some things that should be driving us together in thinking about how we work our way through all of this. I think the final thing, and you've said it so clearly, is about it not being about child welfare. It's really not, at the end of the day, about the child welfare system. It's about the welfare of children. And that requires the active involvement of every system, every individual, and every community. And when the Child Welfare League was established, there was no child welfare system 100 years ago. It was established to address the welfare of children. And the first thing it did was around child labor laws. Then it worked on putting a child care system in place in this country, because there wasn't one. Then it worked on putting home maker services in place. And then it got itself trapped into this system called child welfare that became demonized and all these other things. So I think that figuring out how we take more responsibility to lift all this up, we should all be working around that UN convention for the rights of the child. It should be part of what we talk about every day. And we should be linking in some way, because and then the final thing I want to say is, if we don't get the fact that states are so different now, one from the other, in how they treat children and families, unless we're not concerned about that, where a child is born, the zip code that child is born in, is going to dictate that child's life. Because if you're in South Carolina, you're going to get one set of services and opportunities that will be very different from what you get in New Jersey or what you get in Massachusetts. And I don't think we want that for our children. So what somebody said about the states and needing to understand the states and their differences, we better get that, because otherwise we're really in for a country that has found another way to put people in ghettos that they can never get out of.
I just want to say something real quick. I hope that you have the time to spend the rest of the day with us, because the documentary
that we're all about to see, I think, answers all these questions of how and why. It's going to be spelt out for us. That system of that domination, it goes back to that. Everything that we're talking about, all these issues, goes back to that. And I have to quote my nephew after, I think we had shown him the first version of this video. We had this long discussion, and he's a young man, a parent in his 30s, and he said, you know, what do we expect from an entity that has failed to realize our distinction from its inception? And I'm thinking, he's absolutely right. They never wanted to acknowledge us as who we are, as all these nations. And so I really feel that some of these questions, I mean, I'm not saying it's going to answer all the immediate questions and the concerns that you have right now, but it's going to make it really clear is that it is just a screwed up system, and it's a system of domination. And if they would just allow us in our way, especially, well, I'm going to speak for Indigenous nations, if they would just allow us to do our thing and how we've always done it and how our ancestors have done it in our teachings and our language and our customs and our traditions, that we would start to fix a lot of our own problems. And there's always going to be an outside influence, and unfortunately, I think right now, and I won't go out too far off on a tangent, but the drug and alcohol issue, the income, lack of income, and the drug and alcohol issue is having a direct impact on our communities and our societies. And so going back to that, as my husband had mentioned, that formative age of, again, that those rites of passage and talking and preparing our kids of how to become young, you know, as they grow in age into, and taking that responsibility of being of sound mind and in sound body and before they become parents. One of the things that I just wanted to say real quick is, you know, one entity can't solve all the problems. And I think the work that you guys are doing and what we've learned in the last 2.5 hours is really amazing. I just really give you guys credit for everything that you've all done. It's just amazing. But part of my concern is what's happening, what are the influences in these families and these generations of why these parents, why people aren't being capable, loving parents. What's happening? What are those influences that are altering their mind that is putting them in a position where they're no longer able to care for their children, or maybe they've gotten, you know, they're having families unplanned and they're not prepared to become parents, and so now they're adding these children become into this adoptive system. And why is that? Why, you know, how do we get back to having just a sound mind, a good mind, so that if we become parents, we can raise, we can be there for our children and just raise and provide for our families.
Yep. Okay, real quick. We've been talking about a 1,000-1,500-year-old process, Christendom, the family of Abraham, the dysfunctions of that happened with religious domination, and it's been touched on, I think Ross and John both touched on it a couple of times, at least maybe these happened at dinner, I don't remember, talking about the economic piece of it, and to keep in mind that the whole process is a colonial, extractive, exploitive process, and that is still going on in the name of capitalism, in the name of whatever name of the economy it wants to be given. that is driving everybody into distraction and destruction, and it's breaking up communities and it's breaking up families, and that is all still celebrated. So it's not accidental. You say, we're trying to protect the children. From what? We're trying to protect the communities. From what? All right? Once we begin to name it clearly, as we're doing on the side of the religious domination, then we say, well, it was also a religious economic, because that's the whole purpose of empire, right? Then we see, oh, we have one more. It's a plague that we are suffering from. And so if you don't get rid of the plague, if you don't at least identify it as saying that's what's going on, we're endlessly running around, essentially putting Band-Aids over and over and over again. That's
and I get to have the last word.
Oh.
my answer to you is unresolved trauma.
Yeah.
That's the answer. That's why. Unresolved trauma.
Actually, you're not going to have the last word.
From genocide?
Okay, we are going to get kicked out of this room at some time. So we'll be running by.
Well, then let's get kicked out of the room. Let's go for it. Let's have a party here. No, I just want to put something out, all right? Just a thought. You know, from what our experience has been over here in the last couple of days, maybe we can thinking about and I don't know how this will happen, but this gathering come out with a statement. I don't know how that'll work, but let's just think about it.
On that note, so lunch is outside. Thank you. Thank you, Esther, Denise, and Penthea.